Well, up to 2,000 extra Australians will be allowed back into the country each week under changes to flight caps, with the Deputy PM in his capacity as a Transport Minister calling on the states to lift their self-imposed caps and allow more Australians home.
So I thank the Premiers for their forbearance. I've notified them that I want to see those additional 2,000 places enacted and as soon as possible. Hopefully by the end of the month, but if it's possible to do it sooner, then that would be fantastic.
Let's begin the Australian's foreign editor, Greg Sheridan, with us tonight from Melbourne. Greg, the issue here, it's not about the federal government. It's not the federal government's making. These are state caps that they have put in place. And I want to be clear, you know, there's a great disparity here. New South Wales is letting almost 2,500 people return each week, but in Queensland, the Premier was out there today banging the drum, in Queensland, she's actually only letting in 500 a week. Now, almost 400 Australians have come back since March, but do the states need to do more here?
Well, Peter, they do. I suppose the federal government could do more if it wanted to. I mean, it could open up, quarantine facilities. I was in Indonesia in March with my editor-in-chief, and we joked that if we got stranded in Christmas Island on the way home, at least our columns would appear on time. But plainly, the whole nation has to address this with more urgency, both the states and the federal government. Hotels are an inefficient way to run quarantine operations. Other nations have quarantine requirements too. Britain has a whole list of countries that have to isolate for 2 weeks if you arrive from them, but they let you isolate at home. But of course, that means people routinely break the rules, and as a result, they've got thousands and thousands of coronavirus cases every day. It is a real dilemma. It's one of the reasons I think they're not letting people go overseas at the moment, because if they come home, it's very resource intensive to supervise them in hotels.
Yeah, just on the detention centres in places like Christmas Island, I asked some questions officially in Canberra. And right now, there's a COVID capacity of about 250 only on Christmas Island. Currently, there are 119 people detained there. Now, they're detained there on their way to being deported. Unlawful non-citizens, crimes including assault, sexual offences, drug, other violent crimes. I don't know if I'm paying my $3,000 to self-quarantine on my way home from overseas. That's the sort of crowd I want to be with.
Sure, but I mean, that's part of the problem, really. I mean, I think the government could open other temporary accommodation facilities. There are lots of disused army barracks and the like. Maybe you'd have different categories of people. You pay a bit more to go to a hotel, you pay a bit less to go to Christmas Island. If you're a hardy, strong, tough, fit bloke, like, say, Tony Abbott, who's currently quarantining in Sydney, you might put up with Christmas Island. If you're a family with, you know, women and children, you might get a hotel. But I think the whole nation could be just a lot more creative and energetic about this rather than leaving 26,000 Australians stranded overseas. I can't believe that we can't work out some form of accommodation and who pays the bill, and to make sure that that it's properly policed, because you don't want a repeat of this astonishing Victorian incompetence done all over again.
No, actually, let's go to that. Because I don't know, every day I read a little bit more, I just am scratching my head even harder. Phil Gaetjens, you know, the Secretary of the Prime Minister and Cabinet Department, he wrote to the Premier's office, made it very clear that they would offer ADF assistance. You've seen all the press conferences I had, the PM amplified that, so did the Defence Minister. Yet Daniel Andrews still fronts up there most days and says that, you know, his version of the truth is very different. It's almost Soviet-like. You know, he thinks if he says it often enough, we're absolutely going to believe him over this written advice now that we have coming out of Canberra. I don't think I've ever seen such a calamity of failure by one government at one time.
No, that's right. I think you're right, Peter. This is one of the most catastrophic government failures in Australian history since World War II, since Federation. I mean, as far as we know, 99% of the second wave came out of these hotel quarantine fiascos, and hundreds of people are dead as a consequence. Tens, perhaps hundreds of billions of dollars have been wiped out of the Australian economy as a consequence. Thousands, perhaps many thousands of small businesses and people's lives and livelihoods have been destroyed as a consequence. And Daniel Andrews will not face the most elementary accountability. That exchange you showed earlier between Andrews and Rachel Baxendale was an absolute disgrace. Now, there may be some fourth dimension of the universe in which you can explain that email and Andrews can still claim he's telling the truth. I don't know. Neither does anyone else, because he simply refuses to answer the question. So these daily press conferences, they're a kind of Fidel Castro-like performance, you know. He simply refuses to engage with any question that is inconvenient. He holds the whole thing in absolute contempt. He just says, don't you dare ask me about that. He would give Joe Bjelke-Petersen lessons in holding reporters' questions in contempt. Meanwhile, he avoids proper parliamentary scrutiny and so forth. And he simply says, I'm telling you the truth. And then all of his warriors on social media go out and persecute anybody who questions him. This is utterly disgraceful. This is a very bad episode in Australian democracy, that state governments are so unaccountable that you can get away with really the most catastrophic failure in governments in Australian history, and not pay any price of accountability, and not even have the shame to, invent some way to explain the clear advice from the federal government, which contradicts what he said before. So if there's a way that both those things are true, he ought to tell us, but he treats us like mugs. What right have we got to know anything? We're just citizens and taxpayers.
I've got to ask you, Greg, I mean, you've been in the media a long, long time. I'm a commentator, you know, you're a schooled journalist. There's plenty of evidence of news packages that run in New South Wales about the calamities in Victoria that aren't shown on the same network on the same night at all in Victoria. There's stories that appear from very credentialed journalists in the print media in Sydney and elsewhere that aren't appearing in those same stable of papers in Victoria. You know, it makes me think that for a very long time, Labor has used these smother tactics, as you see from the Premier in these press conferences where he talks underwater and doesn't answer questions. But they've got this cozy relationship that's removed, particularly without the Parliament, any real scrutiny of what's actually happening on the ground in this state.
Well, Peter, I think that's broadly true. I don't know the specific details about packages not run here or there or anything like that, but I think the broad proposition is true. In fact, I think this is a major failing and crisis in Australian democracy. State politics is not properly covered anymore. Tremendous failure here by the ABC. It used to have state-based 7:30 reports. The ABC always tells us it can do things which commercial networks can't because it's not chasing ratings. Well, one of the central crises in Australian democracy right now is that state politics is not properly covered. So you have this massively important layer of government which lacks accountability and scrutiny and therefore gets into these terrible, shocking, bad government practices the Andrews government has got into, yet the ABC makes no systematic attempt to cover state politics. I mean, I think they could abolish all the ABC comedy programs tomorrow and reinstate a state-based current affairs program every night so that the state politics got proper scrutiny. Now, Andrews has taken to an extreme degree this practice of arrogant disregard for normal democratic scrutiny. And this is an example now, I think, of a very dysfunctional element of Australian democracy.
They'll bring all those programs back, of course, when there are Liberal governments all around the country at state level, but not right now. I've got to go to put your foreign editor hat on for a tick. UAE, Bahrain, these official agreements signed today to normalise relationships with Israel. Extraordinary scenes at the White House. This is pretty historic, isn't it?
Yes, Peter, I believe this is a profound historic moment. So in the history of Israel, since it became independent in 1948, four Arab nations, Egypt, Jordan, the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain, have established diplomatic relations and peace treaties with Israel. Two of them did it today under Donald Trump's diplomatic sponsorship. This is a tremendous victory for Trump and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, who has for years had this strategy of normalising Israel's relations with the Gulf Arab governments. It's a tremendous repudiation of the Palestinian diplomatic strategy and their maximalist agenda, which has seen them reject offers of states from Israel in the past under Ehud Barak and Ehud Olmert. and it transforms, it partially transforms the Middle East. It's the most positive and historically important thing to happen in the Middle East in decades.
Extraordinary. Greg Sheridan, thank you as always.
Thanks very much, Peter.